So first, a small introduction. We have been talking yesterday about Spark for batch processing, but from January, we have been using Spark Streaming, mainly because most of our clients were asking for real-time data streaming combination with batch processing. Before we were using Storm, and I think that everyone knows Storm, but with Spark Streaming, we have had some benefits. We made a shift in our platform, replacing Storm with Spark Streaming and making it a lot simpler, a linear platform. We are only using Spark for processing. No Hadoop, no Storm, nothing else, just Spark for batch, interactive, and streaming. In fact, we have improved Spark Streaming, combining and making some things that David is now going to explain in real case uses and with real projects for big clients. And I think this is one of the main benefits of the solution. It comes from necessity, from real-time production projects, not just from proof of concept. So David is going to explain what we have done with Spark Streaming.
Okay. Thanks for coming, and thanks to all the organization of Spark Summit for this fantastic work and support on these days. In this talk, I will explain how we conceive one of the modules of our big data platform called Streaming, Stratio Streaming, combining the best of Spark Streaming and Complex Event programming techniques. I think that we all know and we all like Spark Streaming, with the vision of one stack to rule them all. The Spark Streaming framework facilitates real-time processing through a batch-like API. So Spark Streaming provides a high-level abstraction called discretized stream or DStream, which represents a continuous stream of data. And in fact, is represented as a sequence of RDDs, which is a Spark abstraction of an immutable distributed data set. Therefore, with the use of DStreams, RDDs, and its novel concept of mini-batch, Spark Streaming offers many advantages over other existing frameworks related to streaming processing. So, as you can see, Spark Streaming is scalable. You can achieve scale second latencies. It has a simpler programming model, and it's efficient and also fault tolerance in stateful computations. This way, you can work with Spark, you can work with batch and streaming processing by using only one framework. But what can we do with DStreams? I have collected in this table the most important operations that can be performed on DStreams, grouped by their primary function. For example, you can see operations for transformation, for output, or to operate with Windows. This is perhaps the most interesting from the streaming point of view, all that operation that are related to sliding windows, which even allow us to decouple the original window created with the Spark context and thus perform stateful operations on the streams. But can we do on-demand complex event processing streaming with Spark? I think that at this moment, some complex event processing operations can be implemented with Spark Streaming through user-defined algorithms, but you have to code them and go through all the source code to production cycle. So Spark Streaming is a great framework, but you cannot do on-demand complex event processing. By the way, I will explain complex event processing. It's, as you can see, event processing that combines data from multiple sources. to infer events or patterns that suggest more complicated circumstances. CEP as a technique helps discover complex events by analyzing and correlating other events. So when talking about complex event processing, obviously, this is where CEP engines fit nicely, because they allow you to create streams and continuous queries using an SQL-like language, all of them on demand.
I think that this was one of the things that our projects and our clients were demanding. We had to program a lot of different operations over Spark Streaming. And when you have to program, you have two problems. The first one is the developing time, or the time to value. The second one is the quality. Of course, it has to be good, very good, and you have to test it. And the third one is the deployment, because you have to program it to make the application and to deploy it in a system support system at the end, in a cluster. With CEP, with SEP, you have out of the box several operations and to be able to make queries over the data, just out of the box. No programming, no testing needed, and very easy deployment. And that was the reason we integrated this.
So the main purpose of a CEP engine is that you can create streams and apply continuous queries on those streams. The CEP engines usually provide an SQL language, as I said before, and I think that it's good to understand how it differs from queries from the relational world. In a relational database, you launch a query, data is retrieved and given back to you, and then the query disappears. But streaming queries are continuous. From the moment that they are created, they exist inside the engine, and data is retrieved at the time they occur. So in a CEP engine, there are two fundamental entities, the streams and the queries. They are first-class citizens in a CEP environment. A stream is a sequence of events that arise over time. Users provide queries to the CEP engine, whose main mission, as I said before, is matching those queries against events coming through event streams. A CEP engine, that is important, has notion of time, and it allows working with temporal queries that reason in terms of temporal concepts, such as time windows or before and after, even relationships between events, among other features. Here on the right, you can see that the SQL-like provide many operators in order to make complex queries on streams, such as filter, join, aggregation, group by, having, conditional expressions. You can define data types also, pattern processing, and sequence processing. So, can we, SEP engines, CEP engines allow us to create streams and queries on the fly, but these are problems that we have checked in our projects. You still have to integrate it in your code. There is nothing like an interactive shell. If you want to do something with the streams, for example, pues you have to code it. There is no way to remotely listen to a stream. There are no solution patterns ready to use with engine. There is no statistics, for example, or no auditing. And it's hard to integrate with other tools, such as dashboarding, log stream, or batch processing. So this is how we have designed our CEP streaming solution. You can see here the API sends, we think that Spark Streaming is the perfect framework to build a powerful solution for interactive complex event processing. With this solution, you can use our API in order to request commands to a Stratio Streaming engine in your code, in your projects. And you can also work with the interactive shell in order to test your queries or maybe interact with the engine on demand. Both tools, in fact, hide that you are sending messages to a complex engine built with Zookeeper, Apache Kafka, Spark Streaming, and the CDCP engine.
For us, this is really the key of the product. What is Stratio Streaming? Stratio Streaming really is like an abstraction, a layer that simplifies the use of Spark Streaming, Kafka, which is a well-known boost, and also a CEP engine. So at the end, that we are doing is what we just explained yesterday, to simplify complexity, because that is the key. In this way, we are going to see now how to make really complex operations with no lines of code needed, and really very complex operations. And at the end, we are going to see some use cases where this simplification helps to do big projects and real necessities almost out of the box.
Okay. Let's see the Stratio Streaming overview. The API sends requests to a cluster of Apache Kafka brokers using internal topics of Stratio Streaming. And on the other side, you can see that the Stratio Streaming engine has a Spark Streaming context listening to events on those topics and therefore listening to requested operations. We have prepared a set of operations that facilitate the use of streams and queries, and also automate some of the more useful and common tasks on streams. In the next slide, I will explain a bit more about these operations. And finally, those exclusive operations related to CEP will run on one of the best, that's what we think, this is one of the best open source CEP called CD, and it's released by WS02. The engine also sends acknowledgement back to the API only to that operations that require it. For example, if you are trying to create a stream that already exists or requesting persistence for a stream on which the persistence is already enabled, this knowledge will tell you what is the problem. We have defined a stream query language. It's very close, very similar to the structured query language. And you can see that we have organized these operations in a similar way than structured query language. You can see the stream definition language with create, alter, or drop operations. And also, you can add new queries or remove existing queries. Remember that queries in a CP engine are continuous queries. You have to add it, and you can even remove it. In the stream manipulation language, we have added operations for insert, to insert events into one stream, and list the existing streams in the engine. And this is important, the stream action language. We have added some operations here, and we expect to grow these operations. The stream action language currently have the possibility to listen to a stream, to save the stream to Cassandra or MongoDB with auto creation of tables, or index the stream to Elasticsearch. So here in the stream action language, you should find useful operations ready to use for you with no code. And these operations have start and stop on demand. So you can, when you want, you can start to persist some streams, and you can stop, for example. And there are also built-in functions. We have, for example, the possibility of auditing all the requests done in the streaming engine, stored in Cassandra or in MongoDB. So in auditing, we are saving all the operations that users have made to the Stratio Streaming engine. We have also statistics. You can see, for example, requests made by operation or requests made per stream. And we have also, this is important, a failover system, which we have, it's a system for recovering windows streams and queries from Cassandra or MongoDB. So if the engine fails, when it recovers, it recovers all the streams and queries and the current status of the windows that exist in the engine in that moment. This is the Strato Streaming API. This is Java and Scala API. It's a simple programming model. All the operations we have seen before are available in the API. And it's available also as Maven dependency, so you can use it in your projects. This is the Strato Streaming interactive shell. We can try it in a few moments. With autocomplete and help, tab completion for stream names, and it's built on Streaming API, so this is the first client of Streaming API. Here you can see some operations that you can write in the interactive shell. For example, create a stream or insert an event into a stream, start saving these events in this stream into Cassandra, or alter a stream to, for example, add a new field. So about the language, we are talking about streams. Every stream is a container where events flow with an inflow events input and an output stream. So streams have a known structure, fields with type, tuple-based event model, and they can be enlarged. You can add new fields in every moment. There are also derived streams created automatically by the CDP engine if used in a query. So if you use in a query a stream that does not exist previously in the engine, our solution will create it if it doesn't exist. We'll infer the extractor based in the query. Streams can be considered as tables in the relational domain, but it's important that they are ephemeral and they are not there are not relationship rules between streams. Here you can see an example of a creation of a stream with the fields and the data type of the fields. With Strato Streaming, you can launch ad hoc queries, even remove them, as I said before, by using an SQL-like language. Queries let you connect streams or operate with events in a stream in real time. They only start working when you add the query to the engine, and these are continuous queries. There are a lot of CDP operators that you can use in your queries, for example, filtering, projection, inbuilt functions, several windows, join between streams, event sequences, event patterns, output rate limiting, that's interesting, and custom windows or custom functions. And this is an example of a query, a CDP query in Strato Streaming. Filter streams, you can apply conditions to incoming events. Projection, you can choose what fields you are going to use in the query. And built-in functions ready to use, such as sum, average, max, mean, for example, field type conversion, and several others. About windows, that is a really important concept in CDP. You can choose between several windows. For example, length window. This is a sliding window that keeps only the last events. Time window, a sliding window that keeps events that have arrived within the last time period specified. Time and length batch window is the same concept as the previous ones, but only at the end, they output events only at the end of the given window. Unique window keeps only the latest events that are unique according to the given unique attribute. First unique window keeps the first events that are unique according to the given unique attribute. And that's also interesting, external time window. This is a sliding window that processes according to timestamps defined externally. So you can choose, you can select one field in the stream that has the timestamp and put to work the window with this timestamp. Now the timestamp of the server instead of the time of the server, the time of the one field in the stream. You can also inner join the streams, take two streams at the input, and generates the output events composed of events from each stream. And also you can put an on condition or within time. This is really nice. You can also use patterns and sequences. The main difference between patterns and sequences is that with patterns there can be other events in between the events that match the pattern condition. In contrast, sequences must match exactly the sequence of events without any other events in between. So, as you can see, there is a really rich SQL language with you can do the queries.
As you have seen, there are a lot of operations and queries you can do with Stratio streaming. The point, I think we have saw some of them, and it was even too much, because you could say, okay, go on. But that we really want to transmit was that all these operations, if you are going to use streams or real-time data stream analysis, sometimes you are going to need one of these operations. And there is a very big difference between having to program that and to test it and to have it ready just to use it, just with a single line. And for us, this is the point. All these operations, the Windows operations, the queries operations, the inner join, if you are going to work in any project with real-time data stream analysis, with streaming, you are going to need it. And in this way, you don't have to program it. You can use it just as that, one line, and that is all.
So, how we use Stratio streaming? We have developed an Apache Flume Sync that allows sending events right into the Stratio streaming engine. This sync will create the stream if it doesn't exist automatically, and it's possible to send, for example, filtered event flows only to the streaming engine. And obviously, it's built with the Stratio streaming API. If you don't know Apache Flume is a distributed, reliable, and available system for efficiently collecting, aggregating, and moving large amounts of log data from many different sources to a centralized data store. And also, we have our own solution built on Apache Flume. This is called it's called Stratio Ingestion. So with this sync, you can use log streaming enhanced with CEP.
At the end, where can you use this Stratio streaming engine or this smart combination between Spark streaming and a CEP engine? Well, there are a lot of cases and projects. For fraud detection, for banks, or for insurance companies, you are going to need to analyze and to query data that is entering in the system, not data that is already stored. But for us, one of the biggest opportunities is for data machine intelligence. In any case, when you have sensors or Internet of Things or machine-to-machine or smart cities, or in any of those cases, you need a very powerful streaming engine. And in 2 or 3 years, the data that comes from the machine will be 20 times bigger than the data that comes from business operations and from relational type of data and all these things. So, for sure, you are going to need a very powerful streaming engine. And these are just some cases, well, for call centers, or you can see the conversations, the quality of the conversation, combine it with semantic engines, and this is something very normal, and we are using it with natural language processing. For monitoring of IT services, for log systems, for fraud, for recommendations engines. Always in those cases, you are going to need stream analysis. So What is the point? We have been in all these talks during these days, mostly using Spark for analyzing the data, for business intelligence, but streaming is for operations. When you need something operational, is when you are going to analyze and to convert or query data that is entering in the system. So, for operational applications, an engine like this one will save a lot of work, lines of codes, quality, and easiness of deployment. And for us, this is the main kit of Stratio Streaming. We did it because in our projects, it is saving a lot of time and a lot of problems.
Okay, another use case we are using Stratio Streaming is to combine batch and online queries with one module called Stratio Cross Data Spark. So you can do in the same query, you can mix batch data and real-time data. But this real-time data came from the CEP engine. So with Spark you can do it, you can mix batch processing with real-time processing. But with Cross Data Spark, you can mix data from databases and data coming from this CEP engine.
Yes, you can see the differences in a single query. You are combining stored data with data that is entering in the system, and that we create in order to do this was to create something called ephemeral tables. Ephemeral tables are tables created from the streaming, the data that is entering the system. And they're really easy to use, easy to understand, and one of the main points, very easy to debug, because when you are debugging problems with real-time data entering in your system, this could be really, really messy. So the ephemeral tables will allow you even to debug it in a much better way.
So time for a demo. We will see real-time sensor monitoring using Kafka as a bulk data collector, Spark Streaming as high-level stream processing, and we can see a final dashboard made with Kibana. So I'm going to start a streaming cell console. This is the list command. At this moment, there is no streams in the engine, so I'm going to create a stream. You can see that the stream is named sensor grid and it has three columns, three fields. So if I list, we can see the sensor, the stream. Okay, as I said before, you can send some actions to this stream. For example, I'm going to start to index the events in the stream. Index means that all events are going to be sent to Elasticsearch. So if I list, you can see that one active action is that this stream is indexed right now.
You could combine these actions, you could index in Elasticsearch, but also persist in Cassandra or MongoDB or do any combination. So the module that is allowing this is called Cross Data, because you can combine data from different NoSQL databases, NoSQL databases, and different operations.
Okay, so we have a tool that generates random data from these sensors. So we are going to send some data. I'm going to, okay. Okay, you can see the data coming from the stream. And we are going to add a query that fires an alarm when CPU, which is one of the sensors we are monitoring, goes over 90%. Data is coming, I think. Sorry, the data is coming, but we can add this query at this moment, so we can wait a few moments. Wait, this dashboard is built with Kibana, so as I said before, you can index a stream and use Kibana to monitoring these streams and this data. So.
In this case, you can use Kibana because we have said, okay, persist to Elasticsearch, but you could use any dashboard or ad hoc application or whatever you want to monitor what the system is doing.
I'm going to try it again. So here we are. These are, as you can see, the first string we have created, sensor grid. This is indexed. This is one active actions attached to the stream. And there are another stream called sensor grid alarms. This stream is derived from the query we have launched. And you can see that there is the query that we have added before. So with this query, if we launch again the data from the sensors, we can see in this left panel that we can also show the alarms coming in the engine. So the data is again coming, as you can see. I can put 1 hour. Okay. And when the CPU goes over 90, there will be fired an alarm. In fact, we can force it by insert manually. Okay, we have sent. Manually this data. And sorry. I have not indexed the. Sorry. Okay. So we have the alarm here, sorry. And there we are. So this is data from the sensors, and you can see the alarm coming through the engine. And as you can see, you can add more streams or start or stop the actions attached to the streams, to the 16 streams. And you can use this interactive shell in order to work with the streaming engine or the API, as I said before, to code and integrate the streaming engine in your projects.
So, we wanted just to show it, but the real point here is to use it. Everything is open source, so you can download it from our site in Stratio. So just please use it and say if you need any help or any recommendation to add any feature, please just ask us about that. Thank you.
Thank you.
So we are running out of over time, so you can ask David and Oscar questions offline. So next we have Masaru Debashi from AT&T Data Corporation, who's going to talk about